Ron Archer never knew his birth father. His stepfather neglected him, and a babysitter abused him. So how did he rise above his own brokenness? And what message does he carry to men today?
Dr. Ron Archer survived a traumatic and fatherless childhood, yet went on to become an author, executive, speaker, and chaplain in the NFL. When men of God inspired him at a young age to rise to positions of leadership, he discovered that God does not call the qualified, but qualifies the called. Learning how important strong men are to the health of a society, Dr. Archer now wants to let men know that any man can be instrumental in changing his nation, community, and home if he abides daily in Christ.
Ron Archer joins us now via Skype. Welcome back to the 700 Club. It's good to have you with us today.
I'm so honored to be with you. Thank you for having me back on again. Thank you.
Well, your book, The Power of One Man, shares your story. You mentioned some of the men from your youth, an absentee father, a stepfather who didn't really nurture you, a babysitter who abused you. What did those abuses do to you as a child, Ron?
It made me feel like a mannequin, where I looked the part, I could talk the part, but I was falling apart. There was an emptiness. There was a void. There was a sense of nobodiness. And you're like a blind man in a dark room chasing black cats that simply are not there. Mm-hmm. So you feel absolutely empty and vulnerable while trying to pretend that everything is fine. When you're abused, you learn four things. Don't talk. Don't trust. Don't feel. And try to pretend everything's okay.
Wow. It was so bad that eventually you actually planned and even tried to kill yourself. What happened?
Yeah, I was 10 years old and I went into my mom's bedroom and I had been abused. I had been rejected. I felt like my life had no value. My thinking was, if the next 10 years are like the past 10 years, I don't want any more years. And we weren't Christians. We didn't go to church. There was no Bible study, no praise and worship. And so I grabbed her gun that was in her nightstand and I put it to my brain and wanted to blow my brain out. But she had a safety on it and it didn't work. And I just went to my little bedroom and banged my head against the wall. And I just cried out, not knowing who I was talking to, help me, help me. Help me. And I'm here to say there's a God who sits high and he looks low and he hears the cries of his children. And when you cry out from your heart to God in desperation and hunger for salvation, God will answer.
God did answer your prayer, and it began with another man who changed your life. It was your neighbor. What were some of the ways that he helped you, Ron?
Well, they invited me to a church camp, and for the first time, I heard about amazing grace, and I heard about great is thy faithfulness. You know, we weren't church people, so to hear about the love of God, that he loved the least of these, the broken, the lost, and I wanted that. I felt the warmth of the loving arms of God in my life, and I just wanted more, and so I said, can I go to church with you? And there I met the man that set me on my path, my pastor as a young man. He was a Marine. He was a scholar. And I said, that's what I want to be. You know what? Men become what they behold. And I beheld this great man of God who took me under his wing, kept my shoes shine, and said, if you keep your nose clean, keep your mouth shut, and follow me, you'll learn something. And he changed my life. Pastor Eddie L. Hawkins of the Good Shepherd Baptist Church in Cleveland, Ohio.
Wow, he called forth a leader in you. In your book, Power of One Man, you mentioned biblical characters who came from broken backgrounds and went on to greatness. What can you tell us about some of them?
Oh, my goodness. You know, when I first came to Christ, I thought, there's no way that I can be of any use because, you know, all of these great characters, I watched the Ten Commandments on TV as a kid and Ben-Hur, and I said, wow, I don't qualify. But as I began to read about them, what I discovered was they were imperfect people who reached other imperfect people, and that was God's perfect will. I mean, you look, when God wanted to change the world and save it from the flood, he called out to one man, Noah. When God wanted to create the Hebrew race, called out to one man, Abraham. When God wanted to put Judah on the throne of, he called David, one young man at 12 years old. When God wanted to set the Hebrew people free from bondage, he called one man, Moses. These were imperfect men. When God wanted to share the gospel to the Gentiles, the unclean, he called one man on the Damascus Road, Paul. And he said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And when God wanted to save the world from sin and hell, he became one man, the Lord Jesus, and saved us from damnation if we accept him as Lord and Savior. Saying one man, who says yes to God, in spite of your failures, in spite of your past, in spite of your struggles, God can do an amazing work through you to impact your world.
What are some practical ways that men can help mentor other men?
You know, my son, name is Christopher, he's a military guy, and he was in Japan in Okinawa. I went to go visit him. And he asked me, you know, we were talking about life. And I said, Chris, what did you like most about our relationship? You know what he told me? He said, Pops, when you and I would just grab a football and just throw it back and forth, that meant the world to me. So we learned five things that men can do to mentor other men. One, be present. Half the battle is just showing up. You ain't got to say nothing. You don't have to be a superstar. Your physical presence is the present. Number two, be attentive. Ask good questions. Get in part of them. Play video games with them. Throw the football around, but be attentive because you can be present and be disconnected. So you got to get into their world. Thirdly, be affirming. The Bible says, raise up a child, raise up a man, not put them down and criticize them, but speak life into them. See what God sees in them and tell them what you see. Four, be consistent. The worst thing we've learned when I was working with various leaders is if you start it and stop it and start it and stop it, it destroys credibility and belief. So be consistent. And the most important thing you can do as a man to be a great mentor is first be committed to Jesus Christ and allow that commitment to flow to other people, because I can't give what I don't have and I can't be what I'm not. So being in the presence of the Lord, abiding.
Say that you are a walking exhibit of all the things you're talking about. It's all here in the book, The Power of One Man. It's available nationwide. Thanks for being with us.